Should I start? Well, first, thanks for the invitation. So today we will start the quantum optics lecture. So I have the chance to be able to do three lectures. And of course, you heard a lot of quantum optics already from Bits and Pieces and from other lectures. So anyway, for this first lecture today, I will come back to some basic effects. And the full lecture, well, with maybe some extension, but will be mainly dedicated to Hongu-Mandel effect. So I think you all know what a Hongu-Mandel effect is, and I will try to prove you that in fact you do not know, but hopefully by the end of the lecture you will know again, so that's the objective of what we do now. And the main objective of the series of three lectures is to tell you about a multimode approach to quantum optics, because main advantage of optics, as you've heard before, it has many degrees of freedom that you can handle all together, and that allows you to do many different experiments. So I work in the same lab as Quentin and Julien, so we do some things which are not too far. And we do a lot of parametric down conversion with many different colors, so I like this pumping illustrations. For those who don't know, this is a French comic called The Shaddox, you can have a look. So let's start. I will do a mix between slides and boards to try not to go too fast. So I hope it will add up currently, let's see what happens. But for the first, and the slides are already on the drives that Quentin did set up, so if you want to look, you have them. I'll start with some basics, which are mainly about notations, and to be sure we all speak about the same thing. But I want to remind you how we quantize, quantize is a big word, but how we write the multimode quantum field. So to do that, first we need to consider the electric field, the classical one, and I will always write the complex electric field. And when you have a complex electric field, what you do, you have Maxwell's equations. You find eigenmodes of Maxwell equations. So usually you use plane waves because it's simpler. But in fact, it can be anything. We have seen many modes. It can be Lagergos modes. It can be Hermigos modes. It can be frequency modes. It can be optical pulses. It can be polarization modes. So within this, you have, I will come back to that, you have many degrees of freedom. I put a prime here because then I will simplify this. But anyway, you can imagine that these are plane waves, whatever set of modes, and the classic electric field is a sum over an amplitude term and a mode which is normalized. What I will do most of the time, I will simplify that a little bit because we don't need all the generality, but I will fix the propagation direction, which is Z, and a central frequency, omega zero. It doesn't mean that my field is monochromatic. It just means that we'll come back to that my field has a spectral width which is small compared to the central frequency. It also mainly goes over Z, but we still have some R and T dependence. And these functions now are, don't go into the details, and you can look into optics books, but these functions are slowly varying functions. So often, not always, but in most cases, this function can be factorized, but this is just to show you the degree of freedom we are considering into a polarization term, into a transverse term, so this is like Hermigos modes, and longitudinal terms, which are the frequency modes, fast oscillations. So all of this, so this now oscillates slowly compared to these exponentials. This one diverges or propagates slowly compared to these Z terms, which simplifies a little bit the expressions. You want these modes to be orthogonal, so you just define orthogonality relations. I put a one over V here. Sometimes I might forget, but that's how I define here orthonormality. Okay, so that's the classical fields. And that's very important because I want to insist, I will speak a lot about modes. Modes is a purely classical concept here. It comes simply from Maxwell's equations. Okay, and then when you go to the quantum part, you say that each mode is a harmonic oscillator, is a quantum harmonic oscillator. So I really don't do the derivation here. You look into books, I just use the analogy. Each mode of the electromagnetic field is a quantum harmonic oscillator. They are independent, so it means that the energy of the field is a sum of all the energy over all the modes, and so I can treat them independently and do this very simple trick. Replace the field amplitude here by the annihilation operator here. Okay, so you just change it into a quantum harmonic oscillator. So I did change a few more things, I will comment. So in here, what I wrote, so I kept the carrier in front of the my expressions. The mode, I separate the polarization just because make it simpler. So rho is the transverse direction, is x and y. So this is fine. What is important is this constant in front, this E0, which is the square root of h bar omega 0 to epsilon 0 v, 0 is missing here. And this is important because this gives you that you keep writing that the proper commutation relations. So the fact that the A dagger, like this, I will come back to this expression, sorry, have this kind of commutation relations. So what does it mean? It means that the omega zero is supposed to be the frequency of the mode you consider. And all the modes don't have exactly the same frequency. So here what we assume when we do that is the spread in frequency is small compared to omega zero, so that these constants don't have to be in the sum that can be taken out. So in other way, it means that all my photons have the same energy. Energy of a photon is h bar omega, and the frequency spread of all the modes is small enough, I could consider they all have the energy h bar omega zero, okay? You don't have to do that, and you can do quantum optics without making this assumption, but it gets very complicated and really don't need this kind of things. Okay, so this is a complicated expression, so I will always use the simple expression which is here, which is, no, I don't need all this constant in front anyway, so I just remove, and I don't need all these variables. This is just a mode, I don't need to specify which variable it depends on. It's a mode, and then when you do physics, you have to say which modes correspond to that, but it's a set of vectors in a big Hilbert space, it's a classical one, the Hilbert space of Maxwell equations, with a set of annihilation operators, which now belong to the quantum parts. So this is what is nice in this multimode quantum optics, you really mix two Hilbert space, one which is linked to the classical electromagnetic field, so the Maxwell's equations, and here, the annihilation operators, which will govern the quantum state you can have in each of these modes, and which is another Hilbert space. Okay, and so these two are linear and will interact together to do hopefully some interesting experiments. So I want to give a few more details on that, and I will do that on the board so that it doesn't go too fast. Because here, I assume I take a set of modes, so F or U, so I choose a basis for my system. The light is. Yeah, I guess you can see. Now you cannot see the slide. Yeah. I will start anyway. Yeah, I was hoping we can see both, but you can. Oh, wow. I think if you do that, yeah, it's fine like that. Yeah, thanks. Okay, so first thing you can wonder, what happens if you change basis? So this is a set of modes UM, which can be a set of Hermite-Gauss modes, if you want to have some ideas. And then you want to write the same expression for Laguerre-Gauss modes. So you can define, I put a M, so I can define a new set of modes VN, which is a sum over M of some unitary matrix that makes the basis change. Okay, so this is a new basis. This is a classical thing. Okay, from Laguerre-Gauss modes to Hermite-Gauss modes, for instance. And then you want to write your electric field operator in the new basis. So what you know is that your electric field operator E, so E plus, is a sum over M of AM UM. So this is on the slide, but is also the sum over N of BN. It is V now, because I've changed. This is VN. Okay, because your electric field operator is unique. There's only one. So now if you attribute to this new mode new operators, you have to keep the electric field operator. Okay, I don't do the derivation in details, but it's quite easy. So now you take this, you replace V by the expression which is here, and you factorize by UM, and you say that the term which is in front of UM here is the same as this one. And you find the link between AM and BM directly. Okay, it's really easy, but there's a lot of indices which are not very interesting. And what you find is that the relation is the same, in fact, for the dagger operator. So you find that BN dagger is the same relation. So sum over M of UM you find that to preserve the structure of your space, the creation operator should follow exactly the same basis change as your classical mode. Okay. So this is really linked to the structure of your dual space. It's interesting to look at just for to understand the structure. If you take now, so this is a mode basis, but often when you do an experiment, you have, for instance, one photon in a given mode. I will come back to that. So if you take just one mode, which I call F, well, I don't even need these expressions, but I can write anyway. So let's say solver n of cn, m cm um. So I just take one mode, the coefficient I don't need, but it's I express. And to this mode, I can associate annihilation operator A with the same rules, which is the one which is above. So I will write that like this. I have annihilation operators and a mode. Okay. If I take a second one, so I take a, maybe I should write here because it's, you won't see over there. If I take a second one, B and G, so I can take two modes, two annihilation operators, and I can look at the commutator between A and B dagger. Okay? So this, it's quite easy. Huh? You use the commutator which is over there, which is valid for the A. You use the expression you had for A and for F, which is, so sorry, for A, which is this decomposition which is here, for B, which is the same. And you calculate the commutator. And what you find is that this is equal to 1 over V, the integrand of F equal G over whatever variables you have in your problem. So this is very interesting because it tells you that the structure of your annihilation or creation operator space is exactly the same as the mode one. It's just the commutator replaces the scalar product. Okay, but they really share the same structure. Okay, and it's even more. I think it even makes a bit more sense. Yes. So. Yeah, so,
well, need,
so yeah, so we will see that, for instance, what I will stress today is that the, when you have a quantum state in a given basis, it can be factorized, and if you look in a different basis, it will be entangled. And that's really what Ongo-Mandel effect is about. And that's really the point I want to make. Okay, is that through basis change, which is a classical thing, you change your quantum state. It looks separable in one set of modes, it will look entangled in another set of modes. Okay, I will come to that, but in fact, this is a generalized beam splitter operation, what you have here. Okay, it's a generalized linear optics operations, and I will come to that. So really, the point here is to look at the interplay between quantum state and entanglement through different mode bases. Okay. So let's go back to the single photons, and so please interrupt me if you have questions. I think it's important to be sure you also follow. But if I look at single photon state. So single photon state, if I keep the same notation as here, I can define single photons, take A dagger, I apply applied to the vacuum, and I have a single photons. So to be clear, I can write it like that. It means I have one photon in mode F. Okay, I can do the same with B dagger, apply to vacuum, so I have one photon in mode G, and now I can look at the overlap between these two photons. Okay, so if I look at the overlap between two photons, I have here A, B dagger. Okay, and here I have the commutator between A and B dagger. Okay, so A, B dagger is equal to B dagger A plus this. Okay, so B dagger A in between the vacuum, so A applied to vacuum is zero. So what I'm left with is only this. Okay, so what I have is exactly that, the same. Okay, so really you can assimilate So it's another way to say this. Huh? You can assimilate a single photon state to its mode. And that's why somehow you can hear people saying that doing experiments like quantum interferences or even Anderson localization with a single photon state is really like doing with classical field. Because a single photon state will really behave like a single mode thing. There's no difference. Okay. So now you can wonder what happens if I've generalized that a little bit. So this I will keep. I want to do a two photon case, or I can do one more single photon here. Try to keep time. So now so this is a single photon, I define the mode, I can do a generalized one just to be maybe to insist a little bit. I can define here a generalized single photon state. I should manage. Oh, it's right now. Still fine? Yeah. So a single photon state, you don't have to generate your photons in a given mode. Like for instance, if you have a spontaneous emission, you know your photons can go in any directions. So it's a superposition. You can define it as a sum over m, the same as before, huh? Cm, am, dagger applied to the vacuum. So I don't write it here, but I assume the sum of the Cm squared is equal to 1. It's a normalized. So it's still a single photon state, but in a superposition of modes. But what you can see directly, because this is really written here, this one is equal to this one. Okay. So when you write a single photon in a superposition of many modes, in fact, you can always define a new operator so that your single photon is now single mode. Okay, so this is equal to 1f. So that's very important. A single photon state is always single mode. There is one catch, huh? Be careful. I've been working only with pure states. If you don't have a pure state, this is not true anymore. But for a pure state, a single photon state is always single mode. Okay? So now you can wonder, is everything always single mode? So let's look at another example quickly. Let's do a two photon state. So two photon state, I can restrict myself to the two first modes. Huh? Don't need to do something complicated. I create a photon in each of the two first modes. Okay, and I get one. So this is assuming that all the other modes are populated with zero. I don't write it down, but I have one photon in the first mode and one photon in the second mode. So the question is, can this be made, can I make this one single mode? So can I do a basis change? This is not very easy. So you can make a try and define a new basis, which is a superposition. I do it on purpose, huh, because we will need that. So I can define a new basis where B1 I can write it with dagger, A1 dagger plus A2 dagger, and B2 so I can do basis change with key sum and difference. And I come back to your questions. And I hope this is very clear to everybody. This is a beam splitter input-output relations. So is this clear for everybody? Okay, when you have a beam splitter, when you have a field, you have A1 here, A2 here. This is equivalent. B2, B1. Okay? You can write it at the electric field level or at the annihilation operator level, you just say. Okay? Don't hesitate if you have questions on that. Anyway, formally I can write it down and look at my states now in this new basis. Well, it's quite easy except that I have to reverse the relations, but I took the one which is its own reverse, so that's quite simple to write. So if you write the opposite, it's exactly the same. Huh? same relation, so when you inverse this matrix, the inverse is the same. Now you can replace this into here. And what do you find when you replace into this? Maybe I'll write again. You find that A1 dagger, A2 dagger apply to the vacuum. Well, you have a 1/2 because of the 1 of square root of 2. And you have, because of the minus sign, you have the cross product that cancels, because B1 and B2 do commute. They are different modes. So you are left with B1 dagger squared plus B2 dagger squared applied to the vacuum. Okay? So what you have here is 1/2 of 2, 0 plus 0, 2. And that's Rongo-Mengele effect. Okay, it's a bit of a formal way, but because you have seen it before, and I will come back to that. It says that when you take a photon here and a photon here that go into one beam splitter, at the output, either I've got two photons here or two photons here. Okay, this is not, but it's still a two-mode system. Okay, and in one basis, it is a factorized state. In the other basis, it's a quantum superposition between two orthogonal states. I forgot the minus sign. I have a minus here, okay. One is following, thank you. Yes. Yes. Okay. Okay, that's clear for everybody? So now we'll come back a little bit on the slides to do something. I try to put the examples here, in fact, and the thing you will keep on the slide, because this you will keep later, so you can take it afterwards. So now I can wonder, the question which is behind is, can I be sure that this is a two-mode state? So that I always need two modes to describe it. And is there a way to know, so this is a bit formal, but it retells some physics, and it's quite easy to derive. Is there a way to know the intrinsic number of modes in your state? So how do you define that? If I take a state psi, if I can write it like this, so you can do the same with the density matrix, and it's not that important. So that this one here, this psi p, spans over p modes. So like here, it spans over two modes, for instance. There's two. Then the minimum value of p is the intrinsic number of modes. So smallest p for which you can write that tells you how many modes you need to describe your system. Okay? And it's interesting because it's also linked to kind of a resource theory somehow. It tells you how many modes, how many quantum sources you need to generate whatever state you have. So how can you do that properly? There is a tool which is in fact a classical quantity that you can adapt to the quantum world, but it's originally defined in the classical term. It's called the currency matrix. Which is the mean value, so it's a bit formal definition, of A dagger M, A N. Okay, it's a matrix. It's a M by M matrix if you have M modes. And you can write it in a matrix form. It's a this vector times itself with a transpose. Okay, so why is this matrix interesting? So first, the trace of this matrix is your number of photons. Because the trace is a sum of A dagger N, A N, over all the modes. Okay, so it's the total number of photons. Yes, please, sorry.
In the first equation, so what, so there's like a 5P tensor, zero, and then what's next? I don't understand.
Like it's only zeros here.
And psi p is like a superposition of p modes, right?
Psi p is a state where I need p modes to write it down. Okay, and then say all the other modes are empty, are vacuum. Okay, so I can restrict my description to only p modes. Okay, so it's very naive kind of definition somehow. Yes?
Is it a superposition or a tensor?
It can be whatever. It can be a superposition, yes, of course. Okay, so here, both cases would work. So this one is factorized, but this one is not. But it's still, in both cases, it's still in a two-mode basis. So this basis is not unique. Of course, there's many, yeah? Because you can do basis change within this subspace. So then I can define a matrix whose diagonal contains my photon numbers, and in the diagonal terms are each time the photon number associated to each mode. So when I make the sum, I get the total number of photons, and this is of course basis independent. Okay, whatever the basis I write it, I get my total number of photons. Then you can write something which is simple. So you can link this with this. Of course, if we are in this basis, so I said basis in the form strict number of modes, of course all the terms of my matrix are zero if either m or n is bigger than p. Okay? And so gamma 1, when you are in this basis, is composed of a p times p sum matrix with non-zero diagonal elements. And the rest is zero.
Sorry.
Yes. No, it's not. I fully agree. So this is a formal way to define the number of modes. Okay, I will say you maybe a little word on how you can do experimentally. Okay, this one, in fact, you can. I will come back. You can measure this matrix. Sometimes it's not always easy to measure, but okay. But this is really a little bit more on the formal side. Okay, to demonstrate that you can actually count the number of modes and make and give it a proper quantity. But experimentally, you never have zeros exactly here, and so it's a bit harder to do. Okay? So, but formally, now I guess you get the point, yeah?
And the operator n is the number of photons or the number of modes?
No, n, sorry, this I assume you know, but n is a sum. I don't know if you can see here, but write it here because I need the rest. N is a sum over m of a dagger m a m. Okay, it's the total number of photons. Yeah.
So in the second definition of gamma, is it like a star a transpose rather than a dagger a transpose?
Here.
So
this is a dagger, yes.
So it's the
transpose
and
no, no, no. So this I didn't say, but you need to. You have to be a bit careful because you have two Hilbert space.
Yeah.
I will the dagger only the operators, not the vector itself.
Ah.
So for the vector, I will always write the transpose. Otherwise, you get completely confused.
Okay.
But that's true because we used to have the same notations. So here, the vector is indeed a line one
yeah.
times a column one, and you get your okay. But that's which one? Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. No. This is a column one times a line one. This is what you did. Okay. Good. Okay, so yes.
So is the number of modes zero from gamma?
So thanks for the transition. So what I want to say now indeed is that the number of modes is in fact by definition the rank of that matrix.
The sum matrix is it's zero indeed its size. When you have your p by
yep.
p.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm not sure I got the questions, but no, no, so that's true. So this is what it has to be, and I didn't say the opposite, but in fact the opposite is just what I want to say. I think I don't need to say too many details because you know these things. But now you can from this currency matrix. So it's a Hermitian positive matrix, so you can obviously diagonalize this matrix. Okay, and find an expression, maybe I call it D1, where now you have N1, NP, 0 here, and 0 everywhere. Okay, so the rank of the matrix is definitely your number of modes. So there's one thing I didn't say. You have to be, there's one thing you still need to write because you have gamma 1. You can write, so now I want to use dagger to have my, but to be sure it's consistent, so here. I write a transpose star to say the, well I can do minus one, but this is the one I want. Really, I want to keep the dagger for the operators, otherwise we get confused. Okay? So this one we define in a given basis. And if I write that, and I write a new basis, which is B dagger is V A dagger. I don't write the details because the time is flying a little bit, but you can see that now you can easily demonstrate that D1 is indeed, if I follow the notation which is here, is my currency matrix in the new basis. Okay, so this basis change here is indeed a basis change relative to my modes. Okay, so there's a formal way to derive the number of modes. It's a fixed quantity, and this we can use in many examples. So I have some examples, but if I have time, maybe I see them next time because I want to make a little bit of progress on the Rangu Mandel effect itself. Okay, and but if you apply, so now you can do that. You can calculate this matrix for this remove for the Rangu Mandel state, and you will see that the rank of the matrix is 2. It's really a 2-mode state. Okay, so if you apply that to this one state. Okay, well, it's quite easy to see here. It's really directly the currency matrix is diagonal, and it's identity. So you have 2. Okay. So the number of modes in a system is a quantity which is well defined, at least conceptually. Experimentally, when you do that, you never have complete zeros here, so you use a kind of a Schmidt number, so an effective number of modes. We'll come back to that when I show you some experiments in the next lectures. Okay, so now what we know is that to do Rangu Mandel effect, we need a two-mode state with 2 photons. There's no way to do better. And basis change gives me that. And most of the rest here, and I'll come back to example after if I have time, but most of the rest now, I will try to show you these experiments and do the calculation on the slide. So let's see how much time it takes. So now look back to the original article of Rangu Mandel. So beyond the title, which is always a bit surprising, but it doesn't actually mention this deep. It just says about measuring sub-picosecond time. What you have is this kind of setup. So you've seen a little bit of a nonlinear optics, so I assume you know a few things, even if I will say a bit more. But here you have a parametric crystal with a monochromatic pump that generates pairs of photons. Okay, and you send your 2 photons here on the beam splitter, and you look at detectors here, and you look at coincidences. And you move this beam splitter to see your coincidences. All is fine. This is what you get in the article. What you find is that if they move, so this is the position of the beam splitter. At a given position of the beam splitter, you have 0 coincidence, which means that you never have 1 photon here and 1 photon here. Okay, so it's exactly my superposition, 2-0 plus 0-2 after the beam splitter. Okay, very nice. And if you go out of this position, now it doesn't work anymore. Sometimes you can have photons on each side. So the question is now where the width of these curves come from. Okay? Because when I do this calculation, in fact, so this 1-1, so I explain you this state could be written, I need to write it again, but in the other basis like that. When I write that, in fact, I assume that my 2 photons are exactly in the same mode, with different direction, but same mode, meaning that they interfere perfectly on my beam splitter. Of course, as soon as I do a delay, it doesn't work anymore. But it's not the only problem. So the problem which is more interesting, if you look at the source, which is here, what does it produce? So this, well, it's not exactly what comes from the article because the source is not in the article, but it's a very standard parametric sources, and this parametric source looks like that. So what you have a pump. So this is the amplitude of your pump laser, which has some amplitude at the sum frequency between the 2 photons you generate. Okay, so this pump doesn't have to be monochromatic exactly, but it has some width. And then you have the properties of your crystal, okay, so which is the phase matching of your crystal. So at the end of the day, the photons you generate are 2 photons. So if you assume first that the pump is monochromatic, you have a photon at frequency omega 1 and a photon at frequency omega p minus omega 1. With some probability amplitude, these beta functions, which I forgot to write, is in fact simply the product with this phase matching times the pump here, the amplitude of the pump. Okay, so you generate two photons like that, but you don't generate one pair of photons. You generate many of them. Okay, so now your problem is not single mode at all anymore. And now the question is why, in fact, with this kind of system, you still see Ongu-Mandel effect. So I wrote it here. I got wrong with the function, it's not the same, but this here, so when you add this photon, is very different from 1-1 plus some vacuum, because you always have some vacuum. Okay? So at the input of this problem, what you have is something completely different with a single mode two photon state. You have many, many, many modes, which consist of pairs of photons, and they all interfere on your beam filter. So the question is, how does it work? So this is this calculation I'd like to do a little bit in details. So it's on the slide, so it's also on the drive, so I prefer you follow, yeah?
I'm not sure I understand why many modes, like you said, when spontaneous emission is going to be directly to like many modes, but that's the special mode. So here you have like this frequency mode, it's not monochromatic, but it's like a sound frequency.
Yeah, yeah. So I didn't do the calculation, wanted to gain a little bit of time, but if you write, I'll write it properly. It's a good question. I did hesitate to do. So let's do it. I didn't write it here. But let's make an example with two pairs of photons. Okay. So now if in this term, if I assume I have only two. So I assume that I generate instead of 1-1 photons, I can generate, so if I have a state with four modes now. Okay? So I generate two photons at the frequency of this one. So this four modes corresponds to four different frequencies. Omega 1, omega 2, omega 3, omega 4. So that omega 1 plus omega 4 is equal to omega p, and omega 2 plus omega 3 is equal to omega p. Okay? So this thing, in fact, is a generalization of that for many, many frequencies. Okay? There's no way I can go back from here to here. There's really no way. So if I calculate my gamma 1 matrix in here, my gamma 1 matrix, which is gamma nm is a something is equal to that. Okay, what is this equal to? So I have the 1/2 before. So that's fine. But then I take the mean value of that for this state here. What do I find? If I destroy a photon at a given position, and I do the scalar product with the same system, the only way this is non-zero is if I create another photon in the same position. Okay, so this is delta nm. Okay, the only term which are non-zero is when I remove the photon and add it to the same positions. Otherwise, I have a two-photon state, which will make zero with that, or I will have two photons which are not symmetric anymore, so I will make zero. Okay. So this means that my matrix now here is 1/2, 1, 1, 1, 1. I've got four modes. So it's rank four matrix. I cannot reduce it to two modes. There's no way. Sure, but in the case of Ongu-Mandel, it is not a product. So that's really what I want to. Indeed, now if you make this a product, it's very simple. Okay, but it's not a product. So it's not, you cannot reduce it. And now this is four modes, and in general, this is a very big number of modes, in fact. So that's what is here. So this is a function which is which I want to study a little bit. It's a bit involved. It's not too hard, but just because in 10 minutes, this is always quick to see. So that's why I put that on the slides. These psi functions, you can write like that. And please ask more questions if this is not clear. So you generate two photons like that with some amplitude probability, and here on top, I integrate over the pump frequency because my pump can have some frequency spread. Okay, but this is all in these beta functions that tells you the probability amplitude to give a photon at omega and omega p minus omega. OK? Okay, and because the pump has some spread, it's actually it cannot be factorized because now the photons, the sum of the frequency of the two photons is not always the same. So it gets even more complicated. So how can that give you a Hongo-Mandel effect? So the first thing you need to do is to do the Fourier transform. So you have to go back in time. So I just defined the Fourier transform of my beta functions. And I have this operator here that I did not define, and I want to define quickly. This is this A dagger of T. So what I did define before is the electric field operator, E plus, which is a sum over N of AN UN. So I put M before, so maybe I can keep some M. Now in this problem, we consider only one spatial mode, and then only the longitudinal degree of freedom is relevant. So my terms depend only on T. Okay, my modes depend on T. I don't care about on the spatial properties. And they could depend on Z, but I take all of them at the detector position. So Z is equal to zero. I set the detector position Z equal to zero, so I have no problems. So this, in fact, you can write A of T. This is what people do. Huh? So in fact, this is an annihilation operator. So this is what I mean by this A of T, which is here. Because these are normalized modes. This is creating the photons at a given time T. Okay? And so if you look, what is interesting is to look at this quantity, so which is A of T, A dagger of T prime. Commutator. What is this? This commutator. So of course, I take this and I commute with this. So I have the commutator between AN and A, it's AN, sorry, and AK dagger. So this is non-zero only if I take the same term. So I have my sum as only one term, which counts. Maybe I can, well, let's write it, but it's a bit easier. So MN, so I have UN star of T, UM of T, AM, AN dagger. Okay, I'll just write it down so that it's a bit simpler. And so this is delta MN, so this is simply the sum over M of UN. Prime here, T prime star U N of T. Okay? Because this is delta M N. Huh? So it's U N star of T prime U N of T. And this is delta of T minus T prime. This is because I have a complete basis. So it's like the equivalent of the closure relation in quantum mechanics. Okay, because I have a complete basis, the basis has to follow. This is Maxwell's equation. No? If you take a complete basis, it has to follow this kind of relation. Okay? So now I have the commutator between A, which is defined like that, A of T, A dagger of T prime, which is simply a delta function. Okay? So this is nice because it goes from a continuous space of creating a photon at a given time and the discrete space of creating a photon in a given mode. Okay? And it's equivalent when you do quantum mechanics, when you go from the wave functions in the X and the wave function in the energy levels, for instance. It's exactly the same thing. Okay, so let's move on. So this is my creation of photon at a given time. So this function is the same. I create two photons at times Tx and Ty in the two different modes and with this amplitude here. And this is a double Fourier transform as my beta functions. Now I look, I should have shown that before, but I look at my Hongo-Mandel system. So this is here, my modes A of T, B of T, so they can have some spectral widths, that is what they are. And this is exactly the Hongo-Mandel system. And at the output, I've got E1 and E2, which are given by the beam splitter relations. But what is important here is that in the beam splitter relation, I have a delay in one of the photons given by the position of the beam splitter here. Okay, so if the beam splitter moves, the B photons here is reflected before. I think this is reversed. No, see, it's reversed. Well, I should have put E1 here and E2 here so that it corresponds to the what is here, because this one is changed. The one which is changed is in reflection. In transmission, the beam splitter doesn't do anything. It's in reflection. So sorry, you should, the drawing inverse E1 and E2, I will change it later. But anyway, conceptually, it's exactly that. I've got this sum and difference, but with a time delay. And then I want to count the coincidences. So coincidences is what? Is a number of photons here times the number of photons here. So we can, I can write like that. So it is E1 of T1 dagger E1 of T1 and E2 of T2 dagger E2 of T2. So this is a coincidence as T1 and T2. So E1 and E2 commute, so that's why I've written it in that order. But this is my coincidence, having a photon at time T1 here and a photon at time T2 here. Okay? And I want to calculate that quantity. So this is where it gets a bit tricky, and I don't give all the details of the calculations, because now you have to replace this by that. And each time you have two operators here, so times four, it's many terms, what you have in here. And what you do, to do the calculation, you use these properties, so these commutation relations between the two A's. And you also use the fact that you know that originally you have one photon here and one photon here. So you cannot destroy two photons in that mode, you cannot destroy two photons in that mode, and so on. So when you do that, you're left with terms. When you have the same number of A and A dagger in each of the four terms. So you keep only four terms, which have these expressions, which I can comment a little bit. Maybe I can move around here. What you see here is that you have the probability that you have a photon emitted in B at time T2, and in mode A at time T1. Okay, this is fine. Then you have a photon in mode A in time T2 plus tau, and mode B at time T1 minus tau. And then you have cross terms, which are a bit more complicated to interpret. But this is where the quantum interference comes from. Okay, and this is what we need to look at. Okay, but then the expression indeed is a bit complicated. There's not much way to simplify it. So I wrote it again here. It's exactly the same. So have your four terms of your coincidences. So the way you can get a photon in time 2 in one and then the other one. Then you want to calculate that. So in fact, calculating that is not very hard. So let's calculate one of the terms. So I start to calculate, let's say this one. So I calculate this part. So A of T1, B of T2 apply to psi. So A and B commute, so I can do whatever I want with them. So this is quite easy. So psi, I know the expression. So I replace here psi by my expression in beta and A dagger of Tx and B dagger of Ty. So this is the expression of psi R. Okay? And now I can use a commutator. So these two guys commute again using that relations. Okay? And then I will have a delta functions, which makes the integration easy. Okay? So I have delta functions between T1 and Tx, T2 and Ty, and simply at the end what I have is simply these expressions. Of course, something is missing here. That's fine. That's what it is. That's okay. Sorry. So this is what you get. Okay. And then when you look at this term here, you have B T2 A T2, and the other one is a complex conjugate. Okay. B dagger T2 A dagger T1. So in fact, the value of this term here is simply the modulus squared of this one. Okay, this term is the same. You have AB and A dagger B dagger, which is a cross conjugate. So what you get is a modulus square. Okay, so these two first terms come from these two here, and the two second ones, they are not complex conjugate, but so you have the beta T2 plus 2 T1 minus 2 has come from the annihilation operator, and the other terms that come from the creation operator. Plus the complex conjugate, because this term is a complex conjugate of this one. Okay, so this is fine. I can calculate. It's a bit complicated, but it's as a function of a beta function, which I know very well. So now what is important is, so now I looked at having a photon in time T1 in one detector and T2 in the other detector. Exactly. But of course, my detectors are slow. Okay, and what I will assume is that my detector is much slower to the photon's emission, so in fact to the spectrum of the photons. And this is fair, because parametric down conversion has a very broad phase matching. Photons are very fast. So in fact, I can integrate, if I want to know the probability to have one photon in one detector and one photon in the other, I need to integrate this quantity over T1 and T2 to take into account the fact that I do slow detections. So I calculate S, which is now the total coincidence in having one photon in detector 1, one photon in detector 2, and the time itself are not that important. And now this is easy to do because these functions, this is my biphoton function, this one. This was the amplitude probability to get a pair of photons at time T1. C'est ça. Okay, so the integral of this is 1. The integral of this is 1 because it's a normalized probability of giving have exactly one pair of photons. And then I got the integral of this one. And finally, I do again the Fourier transform, and I get my final expression. Okay, it's a bit of a calculation, but it tells you a lot about the duality between the different space. And this is what I get at the end. Okay, so remember, this beta function is really the probability amplitude to generate a photon at frequency omega and a photon at frequency omega prime. Okay, and this is not the modulus of beta omega omega prime, because beta is a priori not symmetric. So I cannot simplify further. So this is my general expression. If I don't simplify further, it's hard to say. So for instance, if I want my Ongu model deep, I want that this function I tau at tau is equal to 0 to be equal to 0, meaning that when really the two photons are synchronized, I have no coincidences. So I want this term to be equal to 1 when I remove the exponential. Okay. So how, when can I get that? I just give you the answer, is in the symmetric case. So now if my beta function is symmetric, so if beta of omega omega prime is equal to beta omega prime omega, in this equation here, now these two terms becomes the complex conjugate one of the other. And now what I integrate here is the modulus squared of beta. And in that case, at tau equal to 0, so this is removed, and again, I integrate my probability to have a pair of photons, which is 1, and so S is equal to 0. Okay? So it's a kind of a coincidence somehow. Well, it's a bit more than that. But the fact that you have no coincidence, the word is not well chosen, at tau equal to 0 is because my phase matching, my biphoton amplitude, let's say, is a symmetric function. So because this guy here is symmetric. Okay? So which means that the different paths, if you want to say, the different probability to have your two photons, even if they are in different modes, because they are completely symmetric, the different quantum paths interfere constructively to give you each time a Hongo model. Okay? So it's very, very far from the original problem which is here. But it does work. So now if you want to put a little bit of number, I think it's nice to go a little bit of physics. So if you look at what they do in the paper, it's a bit simplified, but if you assume that your pump spectrum is a Gaussian and the phase matching functions of the property of the crystals are Gaussian, then you can explicitly calculate these beta functions, which is, remember, the probability to give two photons at omega and omega prime. So you have a normalization factor. You have a term here, which is the sum of the frequency of the two photons you generate minus the pump frequency. So this is an energy conservation term. It is not fully preserved because the pump has some spread in frequency. Of course, the more narrow the pump, the more peaked is that function. Okay? And then here you have a term on omega minus omega prime. So now it's the difference between the frequency of my two photons, which is this dimension here, which is governed by the phase matching function, so the bandwidth of your crystal. So the possibility of your crystal to generate two photons which are far away in the spectrum. Okay, so you find this is it. And now you plug that into this expression, you make the integral, and what you find is these very simple expressions, that now your S is 1/2 minus 1/2 of the exponential of your phase matching functions times the tau squared divided by 4. OK? Okay, so here you assume that the pump spread is not the limiting factor, so it's small compared to delta D. And so the width of this curve is given by your phase matching function. Okay. So what you see here is the spread of your phase matching function. Okay, so that's what the width here represents. And in fact, it's really in the frequency domain. So it's not the pulse duration, it's really the spectral width of your phase matching function. Yes? So the detectors are, so the phase matching tells you what is the spread in frequency you generate a photon. So as soon as your detector has a flat response over a big spectrum, which is good enough, let's say, then it doesn't come into play. So that's interesting. The speed of the detector I integrate over that doesn't come into play at all in here. So if you look, maybe I can go back a few slides. If you look at the actual experiment, the actual experiment here, they place filters because the spectrum is too broad, and also I believe, so they don't really say, because if you go too far in frequency, your phase matching is not symmetric anymore. So this is somehow to ensure the symmetry of the spectrum. And now, in fact, what you measure is the spectral width of these filters at the end of the day, okay, which you could measure with a simpler way, but it kind of works. It's an expensive way of characterizing your frequency filters. But it is what it is, okay? So now to finish on that, I'm nearly there. There's other way to do Engoumandin. Is to try to really generate that, this two-photon state. And as Antoine said, the way to do that, so either you have a symmetric function here, the other way is to have it factorized. Okay? So if this beta function is factorized, then if you look at my psi function, so my two-photon state, now I have h and g here, I can separate the two integrals, and now this is a basis chain, it's one mode, and this is one mode, and I have one photon here, and what photon here. Okay? And if h and g are the same functions, the two photons have the same spectrum and have exactly this one-one state. So this has been done experimentally. So how you want to do that? To do that, you want to engineer this function, so which is your phase matching function. So I remind you, this phase matching function is a product of the pump bandwidth, and so this is a Siglong and Eiler wavelengths. The pump bandwidth, the crystal length, and you make the product of the two. No need to comment that too much. I will come back. Just want to show you the results. I have one more minute. So this is an article. I'm not sure it's the first doing that, but it's very clear doing that. So I like to show it. It's very pedagogical from the group of Ian Wamsley, 2008. So what they did is exactly that. They use a crystal so that the phase matching function looks like that. So in fact, the what they call the Eiler photon that not depends at all on the signal function. So this is your phase matching. This is a pump which is quite broad in frequency, and you make the product of the two, and you get a beta function which is like that, which is in fact factorized. So it's a product of the Gaussian in that direction times a Gaussian in that direction. Okay, it's exactly what we want. So this is the theory, and this is what they measure experimentally, the actual measurement of the phase matching function. So what they get is exactly that. Okay, but the two functions h and g are not the same. So this is this one is 10 nanometers broad. This one is more 25, and it's not centered exactly at the same wavelength. So the two photons are not identical. So what they did experimentally, they did it twice. Hello? Ah, this is kind of stuck. Sorry, I think I know why. It's my last slide, no, that's why it doesn't go through. It's this one. So here they do it twice. So they have one nonlinear crystal here, one nonlinear crystal here, when they generate these states with two photons, but with two different spectrum. So one is Siglong and one is Eiler. But the two crystals are the same. So now they send the signal photon here, the signal photon here, and the Eiler here, and the Eiler here. So these two Eilers, even though they come from independent sources, have exactly the same spectrum. Okay? because now the photons are decoupled, you know, when you detect one here, the second one here is exactly the one you want with the H function. So they go here and then they do Ongu model. So this was fiber couple, but it's exactly the same. And they look at the Ongu model deep, and this is what they see here. And what you see now is a spectrum of your photon. And you can do either on the single photon or on the Hilbert photons, and this gives you the quantum set you want. Okay? I think I have to stop on that because Antoine is looking at me. No, that was my last slide. So I will stop on that for today and we'll go on tomorrow. Except if you have more questions, but during the break we can do that. Okay, thank you. So the beta functions, maybe some people want to go for a break, but so what I wrote is that the psi is the integral of a beta of omega omega prime of, let's write it like that, a photon that omega, a photon that omega prime. Okay? So I integrate with d omega prime. So my beta function is a probability amplitude to give a photon that beats two. So this is given by my Christon properties. So what you have, in fact, is beta of omega omega prime is equal to the pump laser amplitude at frequency omega plus omega prime. And the phase matching, so this is the phase matching of your Christon at frequency omega omega prime. And the phase matching is the difference between the index of refraction between the omega modes and the omega prime modes. Okay, so this is nonlinear optics properties. Okay, so in fact, this is a classical quantity. So if you pump your laser with a strong classical laser, this is what the fluorescence light looks like. Okay, so it's really the spectrum of the fluorescence light you would get out of a nonlinear crystal. Okay, so it's governed by a nonlinear Maxwell equation in a crystal. Ah, yes, yes, yeah. Yeah, because a four-way mixing process is also a parametric. It comes back to two photon correction. Yeah.